1.1 billion people in the world don't have access to clean water. My efforts are going to be a drop in the bucket. But if I had never taken that step because it was too big of a problem, then we wouldn't be anywhere right now.
Gracias, señores.
In December of 2003 is when the idea came for the organization Wine to Water. We're very involved with water filtration around the world.
When we take the water from the street and we put it in here, the water that's in the bottom is not going to be making you feel sick to your stomach anymore.
February of last year, I get a phone call from someone in the CNN Heroes department saying that I've been nominated, which was completely shocking.
From Boone, North Carolina, meet Doc Hendley. Through his Wine to Water program, this bartender provides clean, sustainable water to thousands worldwide.
This ceiling that we were kept hitting over and over, that we can only tell this amount of people about this water crisis, was just completely shattered. Everything from when you're nominated to getting through the top 10 to being in the Kodak Theater could not have made me and everybody that was around me feel more special. I'm very proud to be a part of this group.
For many, trapped in the rubble of downtown Port-au-Prince, the struggle to live continues.
The earthquake happened in Haiti. Immediately, I went down there and to figure out where I could be plugged in.
She can't get well. She doesn't have anything to drink.
Obviously, you can see it's something that is that I'm very passionate about now. In 5 years, my goal is to have reached 1 million people for clean water.
If you find something you're passionate about, I don't care who you are, you will make a difference.
My name is Doc Hendley. I'm a 2009 CNN hero. I started the organization Wine to Water.
Y'all, I can't tell you how much of an honor it is to be here right now talking to y'all today. This is my favorite age group to speak to because I feel like you have such an ability to change the world around you. So I'm absolutely honored to be here. Before I even tell you anything about my story, what you just saw up there on the screen, I think it's important that y'all know that I'm a completely regular, average Joe Schmo. And I say that, I'm being dead serious. Like when I was in high school y'all's age, I wasn't the best student. I was kind of the average, maybe even a little bit below average type student. I was never on a stage like this talking to people or getting any type of award. I loved sports. I loved playing sports growing up, but I was never the star athlete. I never won, you know, MVP award of the game. So for all intents and purposes, a guy like me shouldn't even be here right now. A guy like me shouldn't be standing before you telling his story because I was always just average, not having the ability to really make an impact on the people around me. Well, that all changed in late 2003 when I learned about the world's water crisis.
I began noticing, I don't know if it was on the news or if it was on the internet, I don't know where I first saw it, but I saw something about the water crisis. I saw some type of fact or figure, and the very first one that I saw was that water kills more children in the world than HIV, AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis combined. When I saw that, it kind of shocked me, and I kind of skimmed through. I guess it was online because I was reading it, so then I began searching a little more.
80% of our funding and research here in the States goes to HIV/AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis. Water receives less than 20%. That night is when everything changed. I was upset when I saw those things, that more children are dying than all three of those combined, yet not only are we not doing anything about it, we really don't know much about this water crisis. Nobody is being a voice. Nobody's getting out and doing anything about this. So I decided that that I was going to be that somebody. I was going to start talking about this.
That was as simple as it was. I was a bartender in Raleigh, North Carolina, and I decided I was going to use the thing that I knew how to do, which was bartend and have a good time. I was going to use that to tell people about this water crisis. So 1 month later, in January of 2004, I decided to have an event called a Wine to Water event. We had a wine tasting. We had a DJ. I played some music. We had a fun night, but it gave me a platform, just like today, to stand in front of a few hundred people just for a minute and say, I want y'all to know about something I just found out about. I think it's important. And I told them. And everyone was inspired. They had a good time, and they gave. And this isn't country club crowd. This isn't, I wasn't around people that were writing $1,000 checks. This was the bar crowd. This was the nightlife crowd. Nobody was rich. But we take 200 or 300 people in a room, and you get them to give 20, 30, 40, 50 bucks. Well, that's a pretty good night. And I had no idea about the success that we were going to have with that night and then others to follow. There was a restaurant owner there that said, hey, I want you to do one of these at my place. And then after that one, somebody said, hey, will you do one at my bar, my restaurant? And it just began to build and grow after that. Well, what happened is, remember, I'm a bartender. I was finishing up school at NC State. I was never really a great student, so I didn't really have that going for me. I didn't really have much going for me. But I had this thing that I had started, and money was coming in, and people were interested, and now I got to actually pony up. I got all these thousands of dollars. I think the first year we raised like 40 grand without even really trying. So what am I going to do with this money? And my parents were living in a small town in North Carolina called Boone, which is where I am now, and there's an organization there called Samaritan's Purse. They do the shoe boxes y'all probably have heard of at Christmas time, Operation Christmas Child, but they also have had a well drilling program going for the last 20 years. And I went, my parents said, hey, you need to just meet somebody in this drilling program and talk to them. So the idea that I had was, okay, I'm just going to continue to raise this money because I want to fight this water crisis that's killing more children than anything else in the world. I want to fight this, and I'm going to give the money to somebody that's already doing good work, which is Samaritan's Purse. So I went and met with their head well driller for the last 20 years, and he began quizzing me after I said, look, I've got all this money. I want to give it to you. I just want to make sure it's going to clean water. He quizzed me for about an hour. Why are you doing this? Why do you have this passion in water and over and over and over? And at the very end of the meeting, he said, I tell you what, why don't you keep your money? Why don't you come work for me? Bring your money wherever I send you in the world, and you can write back to all these people in the bars and tell them what you've done with their money. So I said, okay, that sounds good. And he asked me, where do you want to go? I'll send you anywhere in the world. We got projects all over. I just said, I want you to send me to the worst place in the world because I want to go somewhere where I can be of service, of use. And he said, okay, well, that's easy. Darfur, Sudan, right now. There's a government-supported genocide going on there. And this was just into only 4 or 5 months after our first event in January. So this was spring of 2004. And he said, can you go there? We don't have anybody on the ground there. I'll send you if you're willing to go. So I said, sure. So 6 months after my first event, it took me to August of 2004, I found myself living in Darfur, Sudan, the worst humanitarian crisis in the world. There were 120,000 people killed that year all around me while I was there. I've lost two of my men there that were working for me, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. Because, yes, we're very different as an organization in how we work here in the States. Our crowd is the service industry, the bar crowd, and we do things quite a bit differently like that. But we also work very differently overseas. And because of that, it put us in harm's way. And I lost two of my men. One of them, after I paid him before the weekend, he took his money to his wife and kids. And as he was coming back, the government-supported group that was doing the killing, they're called the Janjaweed, they pulled him off of the bus and shot him execution style because he was working with me. So it was a rough year for me. It was tough to see these things and experience these things, but it's what developed my idea for this organization and how we're going to work.
That family right there had to walk every single day 4 hours to get water. Those kids didn't go to school. They didn't have time to do anything. They were walking to get water all day. What was I going to do to get them water? You could look at that well right there behind me. there were wells all around this camp that had been destroyed by the Janjaweed, by the government. They go up with their 50 cal machine guns and shoot them all up so that they wouldn't work anymore. So I had some local guys on the ground. We pulled the guts out, figured out how these things worked, and we fixed them all. One step after another, we began to grow. If you look at the next one here, found these guys right here, and immediately I went to the guy on the left. You see he's got this big phone hanging around his neck. So he's the only one that had a satellite phone, so I figured, all right, that's the guy I need to get to know. So I beelined it to this guy here, and the first thing I did was said, you know, well, I introduced myself first, and I was like, assalamu alaikum, you know, ana doc, and we did the whole exchange, and then I said, can I come over to your house and hang out with you? Can I come meet your wife? Can I come meet your kids? I brought a sleeping bag and some stuff. Can I just hang out in your village for a while? Because they're apparently, you know, they're really difficult to work with. Well, the reason why they're difficult is because they're sick of all these people coming in their white Land Cruisers and their flags and planting a flag in the ground, throwing some food at them, and then leaving the next day. So it was a little bit shocking for this guy to get a different response. And I did. And I met his family. I met his children. We became friends. And I told him, look, I want to work in your area and figure out how to get you water. I'm not sure what those needs are right now, but I want to help that. And that's where it started. That's the beginning of the organization Wine to Water and how we were going to do things differently. We work in two different ways, very different than other organizations. One, we began utilizing a crowd that nobody would think would be able to have an impact, probably much like some of the stuff that y'all deal with as high school students. That, oh, you're 16 years old. You're not going to be able to have an impact on the world around you. I chose the bar crowd, the crowd that everybody kind of looked away from, to help enable what we were doing with the water work. And then the other side of things is we work in areas where nobody really wants to deal with. So on both sides of the coin, we're working with the marginalized people in this world. And then I meet this guy back here, this next picture, and he changed my life. So I had had this passion for water, and this is a totally different rebel-controlled area, and this boy's name is Mustafa. He began fighting with the rebels when he was 9 years old after the government killed his whole family. He's 12 years old here, so he's been fighting for 3 years now. And I remember speaking to his commander one night. We were sitting, we had just kind of slaughtered a goat, and we were having some dinner, and he's talking to me about Mustafa, and he's like, you know what's difficult is that every day we go out and there's little skirmishes. We fight against the government. We fight against the Janjaweed. There's bullets whizzing by. He said, you know what's sad is that the biggest threat to our people and to us and to boys like Mustafa isn't the bullets that are whizzing by our ears every day. It's the water that we're drinking. Mustafa has more of a chance of dying from this dirty water that we're drinking than going and getting shot tomorrow. And that's when it all changed for me. Here's a kid who's fought for 3 years for his family, for his village, and his biggest threat wasn't the bullets that he was seeing every day or the war. It was the water crisis. And that's when everything changed for me. And I knew that I would be doing absolutely nothing else in this world but trying to help fight this water crisis. So I lived in Darfur for a year, and then we began doing other types of work similar to how we had started, just like y'all did last week. And I thought it was so cool when I heard that, because a lot of people spend so much time planning and they think about, all right, I want to do something good. So they spend so many days and hours and whatever trying to plan out how it's going to work exactly without ever taking that first step and just manning up and doing it. And we began doing that. We the next place we went to was Ethiopia. I found some guys there in Ethiopia that had built a machine out of Land Cruiser parts, like Land Cruiser axles, and they were slamming holes in the ground to up to 100 feet to get water. So I went, checked out what they were doing, and we kind of brought them under our wing and began supporting wells through that. The next place we went was Cambodia, or excuse me, that's Uganda. Here we found that there's a lot of water in northern Uganda in the different villages here, but it was filthy, absolutely filthy. So we found a local group on the ground that were building these things called biosand filters. One of those boxes right there cost $100, will provide water for up to 100 people for over 10 years, clean water, 98% pure water. So we built three factories and began producing those things. And then we went to Cambodia and found a group of guys there that we had them build a drilling machine instead of import $1 million machine like everybody else does. We built our own out of local materials in Cambodia, and then we began drilling wells. We drilled over 100 wells last year. When we first started, it cost us about $2,500 to drill a well, and now we've got our cost down to $500 because we use all locals to drill the well with a locally made machine. And now, instead of using hand pumps that we've gotten from the UN like everybody else, we build our own hand pumps.
So that's how we began to work. We went around all over Darfur. We fixed hundreds and hundreds of wells. I didn't have the millions of dollars that these guys had. I didn't want to write grants to the governments and the UN because then I would have to be conformed to their idea and only go to the places that they said we could go. So with a few thousand dollars coming in from a bar crowd back in Raleigh, North Carolina, I was able to have the same outcome, if not greater outcome, than these organizations that had millions. And that became the whole idea of our organization, that we would be a group that decided to do more with less. We would be an organization that no matter how big we get one day, and if we do get millions of dollars, we are always going to try to do more with less. I don't ever want it to be about money. I don't ever want it to be about the dollar. I want it to be about relationships, because in the end, that's what it's all about, is building relationships with people, saving their lives because of that, and doing as much good as we can with as little as possible. I don't understand why it comes about money, because everybody knows. It's age-old saying, oh, money doesn't bring happiness, but we keep going after it. We keep fighting for more dollars and more dollars, when I think what we'd find is if you stop fighting for that and you focus a little more on relationships, that's probably going to come anyway. But when you focus on that, and that's your focus, then you kind of lose your legitimacy. Because people now, especially with this world, with Twitter and Facebook and all that stuff going on, people, they see you. They see you all the time, every day, real time. So if you're a real person that's engaged in other people's lives and you're really concerned about the well-being of the people around you, those are going to be people that follow you. Those are going to be the people that support your companies and your organizations. But I think it all boils down to my goal wasn't to have the biggest organization in the world. My goal is not to make a whole bunch of money, and my goal was never to be on CNN and to be CNN heroes. My goal was to get people clean water. My goal was to build relationships with the people that I was doing that with and to love on them. And I really do think that you'll find that if you apply that, you can apply that to anything. I applied it as a bartender. I'm applying it now with a nonprofit. If you apply it with anything, it will work. That model will work. I don't care who you are or what or who you're working for. But if you're yourself and you're real and you're relational, that's how you develop relationships. That's how you develop followers. And I think it really, to me, the model just makes sense. If you don't focus on your product, if you don't focus on the money, if you don't focus on the outcome, but you just focus on the people that enable that outcome and caring for them and loving on them and being yourself around them, then they're going to trust you regardless because you're real. And then all that other good stuff will come. So I want to encourage you all today, kind of wrapping it up, but I also definitely want there to be questions if we have time. I want to encourage you to just, it's very simple. Focus on building the relationships with the people around you, your clients, through the social networking, seeing all that stuff. Focus on loving people and building those relationships. And all the other good stuff will come after that, I promise.
These are simple, easy fixes that an idiot like me from North Carolina can figure out. And again, I can't stress how important that is, because you have the ability, I don't care who you are, where you're from, I don't care what your grades are, I don't care what you do, you have the ability to make a huge impact on the world around you. If you figure out what drives you, what wakes you up in the morning, where's that passion coming from, and then being able to use that. again, y'all, I'm absolutely honored to be here. And I look forward, I know we get maybe a couple Q&A deals going on, but thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.